Hi guys, welcome back. We're the Jackson Nothing. This is podcast number 4. I'm James.
And I'm Brendan. And today we're going to talk about some movies. So the first movie we're going to talk about is Logan. We went out and watched it, and we're going to give you guys our opinions about it. And then the second half of the podcast, we're going to be talking about some trailers and talking about what we think about them as well. We're going to be talking about Deadpool 2, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, Spider-Man Homecoming, and I think
that's all right for now.
And Thor as well.
Thor, yeah.
Yeah.
This is a spoiler podcast.
Yeah, so if you haven't watched Logan, or if the trailers, I don't think the trailers that matter that much though, but if you haven't watched Logan, you might want to shut this off and watch it again.
And come back to us.
Yeah, come back to us later. Mm-hmm. Or you can skip to the part where we talk about the trailers.
Yeah. Okay, so Logan. Logan is Wolverine from the X-Men. This is taking place about, what, 20 years in the future?
2029, I believe. Or was it 2024?
2029 sounds right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, about 12 years into our future,
yeah,
where mutant race has been hunted down and almost pre-extinct. Mm-hmm. There have been no mutants for 25 years within that timeline, and that means only ones surviving are a handful that survive within the moment timeline.
Mm-hmm. So pretty much, these group of guys went out and put this toxin in people's foods that got rid of all the mutants, and so now there are hardly any mutants. Logan and Charles Xavier are on the run, and they're
not on the run. They're just in hiding.
In hiding, yeah. So they're not really on the run, but they get there.
So my favorite thing about the movie was it was gory. Like, for an R-rated movie, so many F-bombs, so many everything. It just went off from the very beginning. And then, not even just gore, it was just like...
It was so real.
It felt too real. We got the D-box seats, which was really nice.
We got the D-box seats, so like... Oh man, we felt all of the action.
If you don't know what D-box seats are, it's basically it's base sealed seats. So you can get the feel of base, as well as it has rumble pads. So, say the car is driving, you feel that every bump in the car.
And if the car is turning, you feel the seat turning as well to make
up
for the inertia.
When Logan was like going at it and punching
you
could feel the shockwave of his movements, or even the hit of his movement.
Yeah,
it's
almost like Logan's hitting you and you're going back like that. And I just totally destroyed your wall there.
It's fine. Anyways, so with the movie itself, there was a lot of gore. The whole story, though, was very, very emotional. I felt very
it was
pulled
Hugh
in.
Hugh Jackman's Wolverine's last movie. So they made it so that it's a tearjerker almost. And I can't speak for you, but I felt like crying at the end of the movie.
It wasn't a tearjerker. Like it was, I don't know, it was sad. It just felt, it was, for an R-rated movie, it was done perfect. I had never seen an R-rated movie.
It was
perfect.
Amazing. Like, it's like they took the whole concept of superhero movies and changed it altogether, because this is not a superhero movie. This is definitely not a superhero movie.
This is life and time of uncanny Wolverine.
Yeah.
Like an uncanny X-Men.
Yeah.
They constantly kill, and in every Marvel book you read,
mm-hmm.
they never use the feeling of killing. They never do the actual thing of killing. Mm-hmm. Uncanny is made for the killing of people, the killing of protection. Is that just the weird level of them?
Like, the whole movie, during the whole movie, you never feel a sense of, like, comfort. You feel like you're there with them, and you feel like you're on the run. And usually with X-Men movies, you feel like they save the world, and you're all happy. But you don't feel that in this movie.
It's very brought in closer?
Yeah, it really brings you into the movie, and I love that. One more thing I love about it is that it is so real. It is such a... it's like watching... what's that movie? The war movie... whatever
Saving
it is.
Private
Saving Private Ryan. It's just like Saving Private Ryan. It's so real, and what they did is they developed a relationship between you and Logan, or Wolverine. In the past couple of movies, in this
also
movie...
Laura and Xavier as well.
Yeah, but...
Like,
but
everyone has, like, you have a tie into almost anyone and everyone that comes in there. Like, you have...
Just for now, forget about Laura, but the film, the movies that preceded this movie, brought you closer to Wolverine and developed this relationship with you and Wolverine.
That's true. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
This movie here takes advantage of that. It pretty much knows that you love Wolverine. Mm. It knows that you...
follow him.
It knows that you know Wolverine inside and out. And it really takes advantage of that. It doesn't tell you anything about Wolverine because you already know it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And it makes you feel that thing in your heart when Wolverine gets hurt and can't re-heal. And when Wolverine...
He's getting old.
...really wants to help out, but he really can't. And you really feel this sympathy for him. Like, you really want to go over there and help him and... You know, help him to beat his X-24 counterpart.
So the whole movie, I want to talk about this though.
Yeah.
The whole storyline in the movie was ideally perfect. They portrayed Charles Xavier perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
They portrayed Logan, Laura, X-23, all the other mutant types, the hunting, the racism of it, the wares of it. It just felt very new and different of a way of watching a Marvel movie of all things. Like, I've watched Marvel movies from the very beginning. I've watched almost all of them, I think.
Yeah.
And
overwatched it as well. Like,
yeah.
You
so I know how, and I read the books and comic books. I know them really well.
Mm-hmm.
It just felt amazing how they portray it. Because, like,
yeah. But at the same time, it's like they took different comics and combined them. But I love that they did that.
No, it was even better than that. They just developed them even better than they were portrayed. Because Xavier is a character that's very stern. He's very controlling. He wants things done this way because he's a professor of the school. But if you never read the comic books, you'll never actually know that. You're just thinking, oh, he's just an overbearing father that wants to do this.
Yeah,
he wants things particular.
That's what I felt in X-Men and X2 and the X-Men movies. I felt like he was the head... And, you know, like the CEO, and he knew how to manage everyone.
He didn't, though. That's the whole dynamic of the story that no one ever saw.
Mm-hmm.
So with this movie, though, he goes, he has dementia, right?
Yeah.
Or, what?
He's got this brain disease thingy. It was like,
seizures
like
dementia.
So he gets seizures and whatnot, and he's got the most powerful brain.
He's going somewhat crazy. So he went omega level, and then he's going gamma level, where everything, like, he has a potential of walking and destroying at the same time. Mm-hmm. With...
Like a living bomb, like his...
Exactly.
His mind triggers off this, like, bomb radius around him kind of thing.
So with that, though, like, he was a prick most of the time?
In this movie, yeah, he was... When he got to that senile state, he was pretty douchey.
He was bad. Mm-hmm. But he was always actually like that in the comic books. Like, he wants...
Yeah,
he was
which
very
I had
predictive.
No idea about until you told
exactly.
me. Exactly,
so like you wouldn't know that until this movie actually showed it off properly.
Mm-hmm.
And the people who think that Xavier was an ass in this one or some random thing,
that's
his character. That's how he's supposed to be portrayed. That's how who he's supposed to be. Like even if he acts like immaturely or anything like that, this was really on point. Like,
mm-hmm.
Also another thing I liked a lot more, Logan. Wolverine loses most of his fight. He loses about
60% about that until you told me about
60%
it.
60% of his fight. If you read his books, he always gets knocked down. He always has to get back up. He's always the underdog because he's always being the one attacked.
Mm-hmm.
It's really funny because he's always on the defensive and it feels like he's never on the offensive. But once he snaps, he gets on the offensive and he wins eventually. That's the problem. Like
he just gets knocked down 10,000 times and then gets back that one time and he's successful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, like you think he's down now, but that's never really the case. That's always a problem. Everyone else gets tired. He doesn't. That's his thing.
Like for me at least, I'm not into comic books yet. And when I watch the movies and stuff, I look at Wolverine as this indestructible creature. Like you don't want to mess with him because he's gonna swipe you with his first swipe and destroy you. But James explained to me that that's not the actual case.
The
I mean,
stronger heroes. Are,
yeah.
There's always
most
something
of the fights
bigger.
That he gets into villains with, he loses, and that's what this movie portrayed, and that's exactly how it is in the comic books, according to James. So, I mean,
it was nice.
It
like,
was
it,
just really
it,
real.
The whole montage of it, the whole portrayal of it, it just felt perfect. I love every single second of it. I love every swing he took in the D-boxy. So I took felt like it was like I was watching.
Oh
my scene.
Man. Every X-Men or like Marvel or DC movie I watch from now on has to be in D-Box. It was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely gonna do that again. Also, what I really liked about it which makes me feel hopeful for the next Wolverine movie, mm-hmm. because I really think that there will be a next Wolverine movie, whether it's with Hugh Jackman or not. I'm hopeful.
There's word that there is. I don't know yet.
Yeah. For me, Hugh Jackman is Wolverine the same way Ryan Reynolds is Deadpool. Like they're just so perfect for that role. You look at their face and you think Wolverine.
Yeah.
Right? I don't know if he's going to be back. If not, I think Scott Eastwood would be a good Wolverine. Mm-hmm. He looks like the Wolverine from the comic books. So, I mean, either way, the little Easter eggs in the book, first of all, the kid at the end of the movie with the Wolverine,
toy?
The toy.
Yeah, I saw that.
So that's, it's like they're aware of Wearing the yellow outfit.
They had a comic book in there also, remember?
That's what I'm saying too.
So,
where, in the movie, talk about the movie world, where would they have got that from? So there must have been something that took place where Wolverine wore the outfit.
No, so the way it works in that universe anyway, apparently that universe isn't fully canon with the other universes. This is what we have to be aware of. It's not fully canon with the X-Men, X2, First Class universes, or even Last Stand,
like a alternate.
It's not really. I'll explain this. Mm-hmm. When the X-Men was growing, they were part of the team. They had someone following them, making the comic books. So in that universe, those comic books aren't really our comic books. Okay. Those were just descriptive novels of what they did or what they were doing.
True, but. Why would they have Wolverine wearing the yellow outfit, is what I'm saying.
It was just a portrayal, because nothing was real, and then if Wolverine never wore an outfit or a uniform, you would never really know who's who. That comic book was...
Sort of just a way to brand Wolverine.
Exactly.
But for me, I'm hopeful that actually meant that in this unseen part of the timeline, if part of the timeline that we haven't seen between whatever it was, like 2008 or whatever.
The Wolverine timeline?
Yeah, between Logan and the last movie timeline spot that we saw. I'm hopeful that between that time, there was a Wolverine that wore the yellow suit. I just want to see it once. Because in Wolverine
was,
2013,
I
don't think it was a deleted scene.
No, right? it was an end credit.
The end credit scene, end credit. Yeah. Where
Yoko hands him
Yukio,
the suit.
Yoko.
Yoko?
It was Yuki.
Yoko.
Whatever.
It's Yoko, I think.
That chick comes with a big, nice box, and he opens it up and finds this really, really nice and accurate-looking costume for Wolverine. And it looks functional, too. It looks a helmet.
It looked good. It looked good, but...
Yeah. It was a teaser, but why would they give you a teaser and not follow up with it, right? That's what I'm saying.
It's just fanfare. I think it was perfect fanfare, honestly.
True, but I'm just hopeful.
You're a big fan of it. I'm saying I'm happy with the dynamic design of it, because it'd be a lot different. Like, if you watch an X-Men 1, Storm never wore the white and black suit. Rogue was never wearing the yellow and green and the bomber jacket.
They all wear the same.
Exactly, they all wear a similar fashion suit where they all work together.
Yeah, so that's kind of good as well, because that makes it so that in the movie they're not just a bunch of freaks running around with costumes.
There's solidarity. For
yeah, it's like uniformed together. Mm-hmm. We are a team.
Exactly.
We are the X-Men. It's not like one guy's wearing yellow, the other guy's wearing red. And whatever.
The whole point of Wolverine, he was supposed to be the target, right? Because he gets hit the most.
Mm-hmm.
So you wear yellow. Like, where can you not see yellow, honestly? If you're running in the woods, a yellow and blue man, and he was supposed to be 5'3", running through the woods.
Hugh Jackman was actually like 6'2".
He's like 6'2".
But even then, in the movies, they did a really good job of making him look small.
No.
Like, in the movies, he didn't look like he was 6'2". He looked like he was Wolverine, like a stubby, like, big...
He still looked like a man going at it at full steam, who could...
Bulldoze,
mow you over, just rattle you out.
Which is why I love the last scene, the last couple of scenes where he just, like,
he
takes
out
that,
it's
that serum.
That's called mutagen.
Mutagen, yeah, he takes a mutagen and just goes ape
shit,
and, like, everyone just... rips the freaking hell out of everyone and just...
That was
amazing.
That was
I love
great.
That. Until the mutagen run out, and then, you know, he just gets...
Mutagen is supposed to be, it's a proxy mutant gene that you give to humans, and they can make them mutants also.
That's...
If you give it to a mutant, it becomes a double dose of the mutant power, so that means they can activate more power.
Okay.
It's not always helpful for them. It's a good side note tidbit. Yeah. If you read the comics, you would understand why they hate it and why they like it sometimes. Because mm-hmm. there's some humans that love being mutants, and some mutants that don't want to be human. And, yeah.
I think it's just grass is always greener on the other side, and we see that all the time in superhero movies. So now let's talk about the trailers that we've seen to the other superhero movies.
So in Deadpool. I want to talk about Deadpool first, please.
Yeah, for sure.
So the Deadpool trailer that was released during Logan, it was like Ryan Reynolds was teasing Logan the whole time. It was kind of funny.
You guys need to watch the trailer again and look at the background, the little cues all over the place.
So in the background of Ryan Reynolds' Deadpool trailer, he had the Logan at the cinema.
Yeah, so behind...
Logan logo on cinema.
While he's changing into his outfit, there was actually a theater behind him. That had Logan written on it, so it was Logan playing at the theater.
What else we have?
There was some other little Easter eggs. The what was written on the glass about Nathan Summers.
Oh
my God! Are you kidding me?
Yeah, Nathan Summers coming as Cable. Well, he is Cable. Nathan Summers is the son of Jean Grey and Scott Summers in the future. Cable is a very confusing character, though, because he's very stern. But he balances out Deadpool properly. Like, Deadpool's supposed to be the witty, sarcastic merc with a mouth. Cable is the more stern, I'm going to shoot you now, ask questions later sort of thing.
Good cop, bad cop kind of thing, I guess. Sort of.
The bad cop, worst cop situation?
True, yeah, that's...
Deadpool's going to kill you. And Cable's going to be like,
you're
already dead. Like, he's like the Terminator level. So his power sets are really different, though. His power set has... telekinetic powers, so the powers of Jean Grey, metal kinetic powers, so he can control most metals or computers.
Okay.
And then he could also do, he has a robotic arm that he lost during the war, and his arm is able to, like, give off power into his gun. So it's like its own power source, basically. Also, he can teleport and time travel.
So he's just like a zombie, like a... Frankenstein of different superheroes together, pretty much.
No, not superheroes. Not that. These are all his own power sets. He was a genetic baby made by Apocalypse. He was not...
Okay. So he's not conceived properly. Is he like an anti-hero or something? Like, is he like a,
no,
like
he's
a protagonist?
He's a mercenary. He's a time mercenary.
But if he was made by Apocalypse, would he be on Apocalypse's side?
There's
both
of that. Potentially. I didn't read that story arc properly. It's very long and very... different from the 616 universe.
Mm-hmm. But either way, when I saw that written on the glass of the telephone booth, I got so excited. I'm like, oh my God. So he's probably going to be introduced, if not shown in full character, in Deadpool 2.
Well, Cable is a time traveler, so he could just potentially time travel, jump into Deadpool's mouth, and like, I'm going to kill you. Like,
yeah.
No.
He could just be like, I don't know. If Deadpool 1... was hilarious. It was amazing.
I love that movie.
Unbelievable. I love it. I think Deadpool 2 is going to one-up that. Now they have a bigger budget.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they had so much confidence because of the first one. They've got a bigger budget, and I think this one's just going to knock everything out of the park.
Oh, I can't wait. I can't wait.
This is a good year.
Mm-hmm.
What else? Let's talk about Guardians of the Galaxy as well.
I have a bug to pick with that.
Yeah.
So the monster that they're fighting, if you ever played... what was it called? Black Ops 3, and you play the zombie mode.
Mm-hmm.
There's a zombie that comes out that has tentacles. They call it the Tentacle Beast.
Yeah.
It just comes out with giant tentacles running at you at all times. And that monster that came out in that picture
just
looks
exactly
the same. I'm like, what the heck? Why? That looks really trippy. and then if you do a certain task in the zombie mode, a giant. Tentacle monster in space appears on top of you, and then if you look up at it, it just looks exactly the same. Like, this is very trippy. So I thought that was kind of funny too.
Yeah.
Cause like that zombie mode actually gave me nightmares.
That was scary. Man.
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever actually played zombie mode on COD because it was just too scary. I get scared really easily.
So but besides that, the tentacles look so cool, and then Baby Groot.
Oh, he's so cute. But he's just... You need these, like, supporting characters in a movie
like
this.
Well, Groot is OP, but Groot's supposed to heal and grow faster than that, though.
Yeah.
But, like, keeping him at that size is...
It's awesome.
It's terrifyingly funny because like he yells at you while killing you or destroying, throwing you off a bridge.
Like freaking throwing, like I don't know, like doing craziness.
Also, it's like even in a contest, you could understand him no matter how easy it is, because like
someone
else would talk to him and then they'll also be like, he will converse with you in an odd way and you'd understand it from three words.
Yeah. Which is so cool. It's like a dog barking and you understand what it's saying, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that was cool. I really like Rocket.
Mm-hmm.
I love Rocket.
Awesome.
I love Rocket.
So here's a weird thing about Guardians of the Galaxy. So the girl that they're interviewing them, the girl with the weird tentacles, the weird antennas, she's actually the part of the OG Guardians of the Galaxy. The OG Guardians of the Galaxy didn't include Rocket, Gamora, or Drax.
Mm.
It had Peter Quill in it, though, but it had some other people that grew into it eventually after.
Yeah.
Like, there's a lot of different things that happened with it. Oh, they also announced Star-Lord's father in one of the trailers
as
well.
Yes! Yeah. So, what's his name?
His name is Spartax. No, he's from Spartax.
Yeah.
His name is King Oron, I think? No,
yeah.
I can't remember now. He has different names.
He looks like Zeus in the movie, though.
Weirdest thing, also, Peter Quill's father, his being, his ego, is a planet. I don't know if you know that.
What?
I don't know what that means.
What does that even mean? Like,
Peter Quill's father is a planet, and his planet is his ego. So he's literally the king of his own ego.
Okay, but like, I need to.
It's very hard to understand.
It's beyond my capacity of understanding things. Because
so,
I've never seen a planet that was an ego. So I mean,
yeah, his father's ego is his planet size, literally.
Okay.
Which is really cool, and he's a king.
Like,
of it.
When you run out of enough space inside of you to hold your ego, and you need to hold it somewhere else.
Yeah, exactly. No, he rules.
Kanye West is a god, by the way.
He rules his own ego.
Yeah.
His planet is Spartax, and he's human-ish, but they're Spartan warriors that could survive and have higher understanding of combat skills.
Yeah, that's
it's really cool. And his gun is really cool. His elemental weapon.
Mm-hmm.
It's registered to his father's DNA, which is his DNA now.
So you can't. Oh, to Peter Quill's as well.
Yeah.
Okay.
So only him and his father could use that gun. And his daughter or son, or if he
that's
has
like
one.
District 12.
Cool. I didn't watch the movie, but yeah.
Oh, where only the aliens can use the gun.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
that's not safe or fair.
No.
And so if anyone touches that gun, they get electrocuted or shocked or incapacitated for a bit. And then that's a really cool thing about it.
Yeah.
Drax is it's one of my favorite characters because he is similar to Wolverine.
He's just like a brute force kind of guy.
He doesn't,
but
the thing is,
though,
his skin doesn't really tear. He can get knocked out.
He
can get hit by anything and almost everything. But he's a cannonball. He's like a juggernaut almost. But he could.
What can kill him though? Like what?
In the comics, I've noticed nothing can. The only way he has died is when the Infinity Gauntlet and him are facing off Thanos. Like he has Infinity Gauntlet, Thanos, and then there's another character that's with him. I can't remember his name. But they get sucked into a different universe. I think it's 1513 universe where all the Avengers are evil. And they're just fighting and killing and dying in that one universe. I think there's a cosmic cube involved. A cosmic cube is basically an all-powerful, omnipotent control item.
Like in Transformers?
Similar to that, but it is life.
Like the AllSpark?
Basically, same thing. It is life, gives life, controls life, changes life, and does anything, everything about it. So it's a god item.
Okay.
So this cube descends into another universe. Drax, Peter Quill, and someone else, and Thanos are all fighting, and they're killing each other constantly, and coming back to life,
like over,
and killing, and constantly coming back to life, and killing, and coming back to life.
Yeah.
So like, that's the only time they were proclaimed dead because they're in that universe. And they were stuck there forever. I think that was Drax. I hope that's right. That might have been another character, but nothing could really kill Drax. Nothing could like he'd get knocked out like simply, but that's about it.
Yeah. That's cool.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Spider-Man.
Fucking
I love that
my
the actor they chose for Spider-Man. I think
Tommy Hall.
At least, yeah. I think his voice is so perfect for Spider-Man. It's so weird. I think they just pick these British actors, bring them over to America, and they're like, "Here, do your best impression of a New York guy fighting crime. Yeah, it just works out perfectly. I mean, Tom Holland.
I love his suit so much.
It's amazing.
I heard
about the raised webbing too.
Yeah,
right?
People hate that raised webbing though. They don't like it. The reason why it's there is from the first comic book that had it.
Mm-hmm.
The webbing is supposed to help him glide easier while jumping to the city.
Talking about that, didn't they have the webbing? Didn't he have the webbing?
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
That was the original suit, right? The original Spider-Man from way back when.
Yeah.
Had the webbing, so he could jump off a building and just glide.
For a bit, and then they get more aerodynamics, or twisting and turning, from building sides and going around.
When I saw that, I was like, what? Did he like, you know, almost like deodorant, but like spider webbing?
So,
but then I watched a couple of YouTube videos, and I learned that was an actual suit with the webbing under.
Also, the biggest thing that came from is Spectacular Spider-Man, which is my favorite version of Spider-Man on TV.
Yeah.
Spectacular Spider-Man is, he's a high school student. He goes out with Gwen Stacy. He's in high school with Eddie Brock and everyone. He has a webbing suit. He has the belt that gives off his logo that you saw in Civil War in the very ending. That was the biggest thing for him also.
Mm-hmm.
There was also his web shooters does different technique styles of him shooting it off.
Yeah.
And that his whole design was from Spectacular Spider-Man.
I love it. I have so much faith in this movie. The only thing that kind of brings me down a little bit is that it looks like a teeny bopper
high school.
It has this like teeny bopper vibe.
Yeah,
which is understandable. It's taking place in high school, but at the same time,
for the whole that whole MCU universe, the exact universe it's in, it's not really 616 universe where he's a grown adult. He finished college. He has a PhD.
Like Peter Parker we saw in the first Sam Raimi movies.
Yeah.
Yeah,
or the Ultimate Spider-Man storyline where he's in high school still, but he's growing out of it, and then he has to do a bunch of stuff.
So this is like in grade 9 kind of thing.
So like they took the two universes, combined them a bit, so they could able to do a lot of different things. Like, in Ultimate Spider-Man, Miles Morales, who is the black Hispanic Spider-Man, his best friend is a chubby man also.
Yeah.
So the best friend of Spider-Man, this one, is also very chubby,
mm-hmm.
which I find very, very odd why they would do that now at this time. But it gives it the whole style of it is a lot different from where you're used to reading, like in Ultimate Spider-Man or in 616. All these universes are two different things, but they're colliding and perfectly together.
Mm-hmm. It looks really cool, and especially for someone that doesn't read comics yet.
If I give you the right recommendations, you would understand and see the similarities in them.
Yeah,
it's very simple,
but it's just like it's amazing. I love it. I feel like I don't even need to read a comic to understand what's going on.
Yeah, these movies are perfectly placed of where they're supposed to be, and then when they want references, they can pull from so many different references.
So
and then their fans, the true fans like me who read the books, they'll be like, I know where that's from. I know where this is from.
Yeah.
I can see why
that's
there.
So it's like, you guys would get excited because
we'll have
that,
a geekasm, just a pure
and
geekasm.
People like me get excited because it's just an awesome movie, just...
It fits all bills. It just makes it perfect.
Yeah, that's why I liked Logan too, because it was just such a real movie.
Mm.
But at the same time, it was
homage to comic books. This is cool. This is amazing.
Yeah.
And it's
as you said after the movie as well, it left room for you to go out and read the comics.
Mm-hmm.
So the one comic book that I read that you had given me, The Ultimate Spider-Man Volume 1,
mm-hmm.
amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I loved it. And you know what? You actually benefit from it. It's not just a comic book. It's not like doing nothing with your time.
Or a book with pictures.
Yeah.
It's not even just that. It's just the story of it.
It's a story. Yeah. So it builds a couple of your skills too, right? So it builds your creativity skills.
Imagination skills.
It's definitely good for your reading and like literacy skills.
Mm-hmm.
Probably not as good as reading a novel, but it definitely helps your imagination opens up like... Big time.
You can see fight scenes. You can see things.
Yeah,
that
you create
never...
even when you're not reading the comic, you can create these things in your mind because now your mind is expanded to the point where you can see a lot of these things happening, even though they can't happen, like not in this universe. You know what I mean? Like it gives you these ideas and stuff, and you combine these ideas in your mind.
And if you watch the cartoons or even the shows, you start getting voices of the characters. And like, I'm gonna use this.
Have like a whole movie
Robert Downey
in
Jr.
your head
as Iron Man. I'm gonna have Tom Holland as Spider-Man. There's a bunch of different small things you could do for yourself.
Exactly. But yeah, I think that's that for Spider-Man. You want to talk about Thor as well? I haven't watched the trailer myself.
So there's no real trailer for Thor yet. Nothing has been posted properly. Okay. This is from the Marvel Cinematic Phase 3. Mm-hmm. So Phase 3 is a system that's set out to show off what's coming out in the next movies that are down the pipeline. Mm-hmm. So Phase 1 was Iron Man and the Captain America movie, Iron Man 2, and then Hulk, Thor, everyone like that. That was Phase in Avengers, that's Phase 1.
Yeah.
Phase 2 was the whole Iron Man 3, Civil War, all that stuff that happened there. And then Phase 3 is now coming up with his Infinity Wars. Mm-hmm. So in Thor, Thor showed off Hulk. Like an actual Hulk and Thor fight.
Ooh.
Like Hulk in pure battle armor, ready to go.
I would love to see Hulk picking up the Ragnarok.
No, Ragnarok's not a weapon.
I thought that was the hammer.
No, that's my Mjolnir.
Oh, is it? Oh, shoot.
So
that just shows how much I comics.
So Hulk is
that's just embarrassing.
Hulk is off planet right now, and he's in Planet Hulk. So Planet Hulk is him fighting anything, everything in this world, and he's in an arena. I think Thor goes there to seek out his help and ask him to finish off Ragnarok. Ragnarok is the end of time.
See, that's where I heard Ragnarok. I knew that
Ragnarok,
was the name of the movie.
Thor
right?
Ragnarok is about what is it again? Medieval, not medieval. Norse mythology, end of times. So you're about to. The Ragnarok will kill him. Mm-hmm. With the short Thor will die, life as we know will end. What Ragnarok is actually a snake.
Okay.
The snake is supposed to eat Thor, supposedly. So, like, this is coming from Hela. Hela is the goddess of hell, mm-hmm. who is also Loki's daughter, I think. It's very, very, very weird things. Like, there's a lot of weird tidbits in the entire system.
Yeah.
So Hela, Loki are trying to kill Thor. The daughter, Hela's child is this giant snake that is Abrath or something. I can't remember what it's called. This giant snake that will come and eat Thor. That's his legend of dying in the storyline, anyways. Mm-hmm. So hopefully, we can see a snake in there one time. But him and Thor and Hulk together.
I want to see. I really want to see Hulk pick up the hammer, though.
He can't. He won't. He would never be able to.
He does eventually, though, right?
No.
In the comic book?
One time he's able to hold the hammer properly is when Thor throws a hammer and it's flying in the air and Hulk grabs it mid-air and he's just flying with it. Also,
true.
Red
okay.
Hulk can carry the hammer, but in space. Which is cheating.
Yeah,
so,
because, I mean, there's no gravity in space.
Yeah, that's the only time that they ever held the hammer properly. Mm. So that's the only thing that will happen. I don't know if they'll throw in any other characters into the Ragnarok storyline, because there's two characters that are due to fight also in the Thanos storyline, but I don't know if they'll ever show up.
Mm-hmm.
I can't wait. I can't wait for Phase 3 to finish.
I'm just loving all of the movies coming out this year and next year as well. Black Panther next year. No, Black Panther's this year.
Is it this year?
Yeah, November 3rd.
Oh yeah, it is November 3rd.
We're watching it for my birthday.
Okay, cool. We're watching. What's in May this year?
What's in May this year? Damn.
Whatever it is in May this year, I know Spider-Man's not in May this year because Spider-Man's usually in May, but it's in August this time.
Oh shoot!
I think Guardians of the Galaxy is in May.
Guardians of the Galaxy is in May. Yeah.
So,
it's close to your birthday, yeah.
Yeah. So my birthday is on May 2nd.
Mm-hmm.
Within that May timeline, they always throw the biggest Marvel movie out. And I always watch it on my birthday, which is funny for me because I love it and I'm happier that
usually
that
alone.
No, last year I had 2 years ago I had my girlfriend, my ex-girlfriend. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great. So I think that's all the time we have for today.
Yeah.
Like and subscribe us, please.
Check out our website and view all of our social media from there. Mm-hmm. Also, let us know what you guys would like to see in the future, whether it's a topic to talk about.
Yeah.
Or if it's just DIY videos or something that you would like to see on our YouTube channel.
We're hoping to do more videos like podcasts. We have a lot of things we want to talk about. I think we want to get into gaming one day also and do a bunch of stuff like that.
Yeah, so let us know how we're doing and definitely like us. Because we're so likable.
Thank you.
We love you.
Yes. Bye.